Graz University of Technology. She got her PhD in 2003, and she became a lecturer in Bristol University of, University of Bristol in 2006, where she became a professor in applied cryptography, being apparently the first female to hold a professor position in this university in computer science department. Then she moved to University of Klagenfurt since last year as an honorary professor of applied cryptography. And there she's the first professor at the newly founded Digital Age Research Center. She likes to be the first in many places, apparently. So in her professional career, she was mainly working on power analysis attacks. She has also contributed to the areas of efficient implementations of ciphers and cryptanalysis of hash functions. In recent years, she has also served as to the community as a program committee chair, of chairs of Eurocrypt. I was honored to be together with her general chair of one of the Eurocrypt that she was program chair in 2015 in Sofia. She's also holder of at least two very prestigious grants, the Leadership Fellowship from the UK Research Council of Engineering and Physical Sciences, and an Consolidator ERC grant, which she has now. She has also written a book, Power Analysis Attacks, which I think is on the desk of every PhD student nowadays, which starts working in this field. So I would like to start with the easy questions, I guess. I don't know if they will be easier or not, but you have said in one of the interviews which I found on your website that it's a privilege for you to be able to accompany students on their way of acquiring knowledge and personal development. I believe this is so. And can you tell us a little bit more about why and what makes you like working so much with students and helping them in their way to science and to build their career?
Okay, it's a very open-ended question. I suppose I do enjoy simply working with people, and I do enjoy working one-to-one more than being in a big group. I think it kind of works together with my personality style. I'm probably more introverted than extroverted. I hate large crowds. It does really nothing for me. But having a good conversation with an individual that, I don't know, it just makes my day often. And especially when it comes to PhD students, you get to know them at the start of something, I would say, really big that they set out to do. Often, I would say the vast majority of people don't really know how big it is, what they are embarking on, how much effort and heartache and setbacks there will be, and how much you really benefit from being in a supportive environment. And different people come in with different ideas, but over time they encounter all these challenges, and you can really see them, how they grow as people, how they start to deal differently with comments they get, reviews they get, interactions they have in conferences, and they often change dramatically as people. And it's just amazing, I would say, to be able to be part of somebody's life for 3 or 4 years, where you see them often nearly every day and you have lots of interesting conversations. You can learn from them as well. I mean, that's one of the, I think, biggest perks, that you can give somebody a question you'd like an answer to, and they will feel obliged to go away and work really hard on it. I think it's a win-win situation, ideally, at least most of the times it is. So yeah, there are lots of reasons why I enjoy this.
Did you notice specifically female students to choose you just because you're the role model and you show that female can actually achieve things in this field? Or?
I don't think so. Okay. I don't think so. No, I think the female students I've had or have now, they've arrived because they're interested in side channels, not because of me necessarily as a person.
Okay, moving on. You have also been very active member of the community. You often, either it happened to be like at Eurocrypt, you were the first to introduce the parallel sessions, which was a lot of debate before that, and nobody dared actually to do that. But yeah, we did it somehow. So you always have like the courage to do new things. You also, I think, if I'm not wrong, you are one of the people that is proposing this new journal to ICR to change in a way the publication model. Can you share with us some ideas about how community should be improved in any aspect, publications, the way it works, conferences now, that's also probably one big question. Mm-hmm. How should we organize conferences in the future after this super weird situation hopefully is gone?
Yeah.
And we learn maybe something from it? Can we improve anything?
Yeah, I mean, there's, as you know, any community changes and keeps changing. I think we as a community have changed dramatically in comparison to many others because we have grown so much over the last 10 to 15 years from when CHESS was conceived in 1999. I don't know, meeting of no more than 50 people to having 400, 450 people being interested in this topic. I mean, this is a massive increase. And running events, community events in exactly the way as they were, despite the parameters around having changed so much, doesn't seem very logical to me. I also don't, so perhaps one of the things that I find important is that the CHESS community, from my point of view, is part of the wider crypto and security community. And I'd like the idea that some of our events bring together people, not just from a certain area, but from the wider communities of within crypto and security. And so it's, in a way, it's important to me that we grow in a way that we don't splinter as a community. And then another way, I think it's of course important that there are special interest kind of conferences. And I think over the years, you mentioned Eurocrypt. We kept running everything as a single track conference. We rejected loads and loads of papers that were clear accepts for no other reason than there was a lottery basically about there were only so many spaces and many more papers. And we had to find ways to kind of then accept only that many papers. So going dual track just seemed to make imminent sense. And I don't know whether it was a coincidence that I happened to be the program chair or whether there was some plan of some sorts, but I certainly saw the point and was quite happy to go ahead with it. And yes, I got lots of interesting emails and feedback as a result. I'm not sure that everyone has forgiven me for that, but I think it was the right thing to do. And by now, nobody really, I think, challenges it that much. And you also mentioned the kind of suggestion that we indeed took to the ISER board about essentially establishing a new journal. We call it, I think, Transactions on Cryptography, which would take papers from all of the community where publication is not equated with a presentation slot at a conference. So you're not having any other arbitrary limits. The idea is simply to create a venue where hopefully in a slightly more collaborative way, really good papers can be published from all over the crypto community. So I think the ISER board is now kind of having some working group for it and thinking how to ensure that really all of the communities within crypto can be well represented, probably via a specific editorial kind of board structure. So that we start to slightly decouple a publication with a conference presentation for those who wish to do it. There's no talk about abolishing anything as a result. It's just an additional offering.
Okay.
So that's kind of the brief kind of explanation about that.
Okay. I have more questions, but I'll move on to the Zulip questions now. There is a question about your book. Any project for an update version of the DPA book, the result of the last 10 plus years of research to include?
Yeah. I know, I get regular questions and my answer tends to be, I just don't know. I mean, an update wouldn't be sufficient. It would need a complete rewrite in a way. We've had conversations with Stefan and other people, but I think we just don't have enough drive yet to do it. Maybe okay. At some point we will have enough motivation.
Question from Kevin. Do you have any suspicion of other side channels that are ripe for exploiting, such as EMF or other observations?
What is EMF? Sorry.
Electromagnetic fields, I assume, Kevin?
But that we already exploit. That, so if it's not that, I don't know what this would be.
Maybe he
That's the question, I think, is what are the other things that could be exploited?
Yeah. Well, you know, in our community, when it comes to physical side channels, I think we kind of utilize everything. So we've got our EM timing, we've got optical emanations, there was sound. So I think I can't kind of conjure up anything else that would have a sort of a more physical manifestation. When it comes to other areas, I mean, in principle, any data dependency is a source for a side channel attack. And there are data dependencies all over the place. Whether this is now, again, manifesting itself via timing or via cache side channels. If you look at the systems community and the barrage of side channel attacks that they are publishing, they're all just simple data dependencies that somewhere occur. And I would expect that there will be more of those, yeah. But pinpointing some specific one, no, I don't have anything on my mind right now.
Okay, a bit more general question from you all. After over 25 years of side channel research, is there anything left to discover? I hope still there is, but.
Discover, I mean, I think that we are still better in mounting new variations of attacks than actually coming up with more practical variations of known countermeasures. So I think we are still not in a good place with regards to implementations and how we can ensure that something that gets published as a seemingly secure algorithm or implementation strategy actually ends up as something that somebody can take and implement as it is described on a new device and it will actually work. So we are nowhere near that. So I would say there's plenty more to be done, but perhaps more on the modeling kind of area, on the bringing together theory and practice area, tools and so on. That would be my take.
And Ingrid wants to know, what are the next research topics or trends we should embrace at CHESS?
Ooh, that's a dangerous question. I'm not a trendsetter, but for me, I think we need still a better understanding of how commodity devices really leak, so we can check whether certain proof assumptions match reality. I think largely they don't, but we don't know what the gap is. And I think from my point of view, our community has got a responsibility towards other communities to make it clearer where theory and practice diverge and to explain how this can be dealt with. And then there's lots of stuff in relation to post-quantum crypto, and there's lots of stuff in relation to MPC, where perhaps the what I would call current implementations research hasn't really hit the CHESS community yet, where people work on algorithms and improve them, and there are speedups of factor 20 and whatever. So this is typically outside of CHESS, but eventually this will perhaps settle a bit more, and then I would say there's also lots for us to do eventually.
Kevin has another question. One major hardware trend is the development of GPUs tailored to machine learning. Do you see any particular advantages or weaknesses in this when they are used for cryptographic systems?
So they are part of a deployed crypto system, and the question is, are they particularly vulnerable?
Yeah. Okay. Or is there any advantage if using it for cryptographic systems?
Well, we don't really know much about the leakage characteristics of them. I would suppose that all of these, what we now call software-induced hardware side channels, so all of the row hammering and other things, if there are components that behave similarly on GPUs, they will be equally vulnerable. So I'm sure there can be lots of papers be written about how you induce software-based fault attacks on these things as well. In terms of leakage, we tend to have these ideas that just because things run fast, we can't capture the leakage. But whenever somebody has tried on devices with high clock frequencies, typically we were able to capture some leakage. So I would guess that there's perhaps quite a lot that can be done with power and EM attacks if we just really try hard enough. I can't see why there wouldn't be timing vulnerabilities. So my feeling is that saying that doing crypto on GPUs or something, it can't be per se more secure. I think there would be equally many issues. Can it give us other advantages? I mean, within networks, we've sometimes tried to use it for speed ups, but they are not ideally suitable for the kind of use case that we have. I don't think a lot of people at the moment use them kind of for constructive side channel research.
Okay, and now moving a bit to a different direction, you are leading the only Horizon 2020 project for certification, as far as I know, mm-hmm. I'm really sure. And there is also a question in the Zulip about CC, common criterion FIPS. They ask about your thoughts on the current concepts of common criterion FIPS in terms of side channel evaluation and what direction mm-hmm. should those schemes head to. You probably mm-hmm. are also aware of the NIST initiative to standardize threshold-based algorithms in general, but also for protection of side channel against side channel attacks and faults eventually. So what are your thoughts on this? This is a very important aspect also for our work, how we actually evaluate and certificate the good implementations and differentiate from the not so good.
Indeed, so there was ReAssure, it concluded this year in March. If people are really interested in our findings, then there is a website, it's reassure.eu. And all of our deliverables, all of the published work can be found there. Also, we have got lots of data sets and so on. So this is all accessible from the website, and I would encourage people to have a look. So deliverables and so on, you can simply read through, and they in part answer exactly this question, what is the state of the art of these certification schemes? What are pros and cons? We've also done a slightly shorter write-up, which is being reviewed at the moment. And eventually, I'm sure we will put the paper anyway on ePrint, where we kind of tried to compare common criteria with regards to the smart card kind of focused evaluation scheme. So the thing that is governed by JHAZ with NIST FIPS 140-3 and something that we call really using the worst case adversary stroke backwards evaluation approach. Now, taking this in turn, so common criteria is a very well established kind of routine. JHAZ is a stakeholder group which kind of has a significant say over how evaluations proceed. And they certainly have, I would say, the intention and the interest to ensure that products are as safe as they can be, and the evaluation, I would say, approach really tries to get close to finding out what is the best possible attack that one can do. They are, I think, prominent in the chess community, the members there. They certainly take our research into account. Perhaps the biggest criticism that we had and that we also communicated to them, so I was invited to give a talk this year and to sort of give our thoughts from within the ReAssure consortium, is that perhaps it needs to be more emphasized to really try and achieve the so-called worst case adversary, which is an adversary that has access to lots and lots of information, perhaps more so than a realistic adversary would have, but just to kind of be sure that you really get in a way to the worst case. And they were open to this. So the idea would be that you really have to profile very carefully. The more information you give to the evaluator, the more they can get out in the profiling phase. And this is what we found the most important part of any evaluation that will determine how close you are to the true best attack or how far you are away. Then when it comes to NIST FIPS 140-3, This is a totally different story. This is a standard that tries to minimize the cost and tries to just establish a sort of a baseline security. Well, by that baseline, I would say it's so low that perhaps we should all be extremely worried. We also had a paper in AsiaCrypt 2019 where we specifically looked at how they instantiated TVLA as part of their framework, and there are a number of grave mistakes, which means that if you use that as described in the standard, you are likely to reject all devices, but because of the wrong leaks that you identify. So this is something has gone really wrong there. And I know that this standard has been reopened and there will be changes to it. And then our own suggestion is what we call the worst case approach, where you really, mercilessly go, give as much information as you can, such that the evaluator is really able to instantiate the best possible attack. So summarizing common criteria, very reliable, very sophisticated, but there are some things which I believe, or we believed as a consortium, could be improved. NIST 140-3, not really at the moment. And that's sort of where we left it.
Okay. I see no more questions on the Zulip, but I have one last question following the last things that happened tonight, yesterday night, apparently. You have heard probably that NVIDIA has acquired ARM. I don't know, is this just a business decision, or do you think it will have an impact on our work? Maybe it would help give more opportunities for RISC-V, or I don't know, maybe you don't even know what, nobody knows what will happen probably, but...
I think it's a very interesting move. Yeah, I think it provides NVIDIA for a number of new opportunities, as ARM processors are the future for Apple. So this gives them a new stake in a market that they weren't in before. Whether this has any immediate impact on us is another question. I mean, ARM has got, of course, their own. They are aware of side channels. They perhaps take things like timing and cache attacks more serious than power and DM. That's my reading of what they do internally. The idea was that I think the research stays in Europe. So maybe that means there is an opportunity for expansion of that. But that's, I would say, more up in the air with ownership changing on that scale.
Yeah, it's difficult to say. I think we are exactly at the end of the time that we were supposed to spend for this session. I don't see more questions. I would like to thank you very much for the very insightful and interesting talk. And thank you, everybody, for asking the questions.
Thank you for having me.
I guess now follows a social event. Kevin, maybe you can say more about it.
Yes.